Hi, folks. Ryan Honeyman here from Lyft Economy. Many folks have come to us over the last 10 years and asked, how do I get more involved in creating an economy that works for the benefit of all life? They also ask, what skills and experiences do I need to help make this transition? So 3 years ago, we created something called the Next Economy MBA to help address this and similar questions. Lyft Economy's Next Economy MBA is an online course that's designed for entrepreneurs, aspiring entrepreneurs, students, recent graduates, employees, and folks who want to learn more about transformational next economy strategies and businesses. Join the growing alumni network of nearly 250 alumni who've gone through this program and learned essential skills and hopefully built lifelong relationships for catalyzing businesses in the emergent and regenerative economy. So we encourage you to check out our course. You can go to lifteconomy.com/MBA. The next course, Cohort 7, starts on September 21st, 2021. So once again, go to www.lifteconomy.com/MBA. And now, on with the show. Welcome to Next Economy Now. The goal of this podcast series is to highlight the leaders who are taking a regenerative, bioregional, equitable, democratic, racially just, and whole systems approach to creating the new economy. Resma, welcome to the show.
Man, thank you. I appreciate you for having me.
Man, as a fellow author, it must feel good to have that New York Times bestseller as a preface.
I can't lie. You know how sometimes people try to be all humble and shucky. I'm like, shit, that's cool as hell, man. I like it. So, yeah, it's unfortunate that it happened on the backs of and things like this continue to happen on the backs of Black folks. Right. It's unfortunate that my book, and I make no amends about this, my book, George Floyd, Sister Breonna Taylor, and Brother Ahmaud died in that period. And I think people were looking for something to help them either grieve or figure out, like, why is this happening? And my book is just one of those books that caught on. But those ancestors in the hundreds, millions of ancestors before them paid the price for that book to be successful. And I don't take that in any small measure. I mean, my own personal gratification is one thing, but I also understand that that's on the shoulders of my ancestors. So, you know.
And, you know, just so folks can get a sense of who you are, can you speak a little bit about your background, you know, maybe where you're raised and like how you got interested in the work you're doing today?
Yeah. Born and raised in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. I went to Bayview High School, which was at the time a music and arts high school. And the reason why I went there, I was bused there because I had a leaning towards art and music and stuff like that. And so from kindergarten through sixth grade, I was in an all Black and Puerto Rican neighborhood, some poor whites, but as soon as they could, they left. And then when I got to about sixth grade, it was the first time I had been exposed to white people en masse, right? And then high school, and went to college, University of La Crosse, Wisconsin, and got my undergrad in sociology, gerontology, and psychology. I then came up here. My hair used to be a lot longer then. And then I came to Minneapolis thinking I was going to be the next prince and needed to actually eat. So I started doing work in my profession and stuff like that. So I've been doing this for 30 years. I'm a clinical social worker. I do private practice. I'm married with two kids, 35 and 20. Both my parents now, my parents and brothers live down in Texas, and my grandmother's hands is actually my third book. So I'm working on the next one right now too. So.
Wow. And I probably should have opened with this, but I was thinking just like on a soul, on a soul level, how are you doing right now?
Rough. It's rough. It's a lot of collective tiredness in my community right now. There's a lot of collective fatigue, right? There's a lot of, you know, the Black body has not known rest as a collective in this country, right? Our bodies have been put upon to service white bodies. And so there's a collective grief and a collective fatigue that many of us think is individual, but is showing up in the collective. And so in the cultural collective, and I think that, you know, my sleeping's been off, my rage has been off the charts, my eating is not where it was. And at the same time, I'm having to try and, my wife is trying to hold me, I'm trying to hold her and hold her nervous system, and her stuff is thrown off. And it's just, you know, we're not going back to the way things were. And no matter how much white people want to go back, going back to the way that things were wasn't good for Black people, wasn't good for Indigenous people, wasn't good for little brown babies getting locked in cages, right? Wasn't good for people who practice the Muslim faith. Right.
Wasn't even good for white folks.
It wasn't even good for white folks. But here's the deal. White folks get such benefit and are advantaged by being born in a society that's predicated on the white body being the supreme standard by which all bodies' humanity shall be measured. Right. So when you're born in a society like that, you are advantaged before the police, the system of policing blows the back out of my people, right? You are advantaged by being born in a white body in a society that's predicated on a white body being the standard of humanness. You know, one of the things I always tell people is that the race question in this country is actually not a race question. It's actually a species question. It's always been a species question. The term race is a term that was used, that was a term that was used to identify species, right? And so the question in this country that has been woven in, around, and through every institution in this country is Resma a monkey? Now, when people hear that, right, some people that are listening to this thing will be like, oh my God. But that is the one thing that we need to start leaning into, because white folks in particular need to, you know, it ain't enough to be shocked about that shit, right? It ain't enough to be like, oh my God, right? You don't say that in polite company. Yeah, you don't say it in polite company, but you all right with the state and your name blowing the backs out of Black folks. You all right with the state in your name shooting women while they're sleeping, Black women while they're sleeping, shooting them while they're sleeping in their beds, right? But you don't want me to say, you don't want me to say that your body has been rendered structurally, not innately, not intrinsically, structurally rendered the standard of humanness. That philosophy is something that white people have yet as a collective to begin to deal with. And that affects economies. This idea of whiteness is an economic question. It is an economic question. The idea of me being a species, not a full human, is an economic question. Now you're going to have some liberal ass white people that are going to be on here and listening to this and think, oh, we're all the same. And we're all, you know, that ain't what I'm talking about. I don't need you to validate my intrinsic value. I don't need you to use your white gaze to evaluate my people's intrinsic value. That's for us to do. What I need you to do is get in the mode of developing a living, embodied, anti-racist culture and philosophy. That's what I need you to do. I don't care what you think about Colin Kaepernick. I don't care what you think about George Floyd. And I don't want you to ask me. I need you to be about the work of ushering in a new reality for your people so my people can breathe. That's what I need. And so, yeah, that's the species question, man. It gets like when white folks say, well, how did this happen? I didn't. Oh, my God. You know, and one of the first things that I say is, you don't know Google. Do you know how to Google shit? If you cared about this, you could know about this. The fact that you're surprised means that you have now rendered yourself dangerous to me. Right. You're coming to me as you're saying things like, I didn't know. And oh, my God, this is horrible. And we need to do something. And you're thinking that you're communicating support, but you're actually communicating danger. Right. So that's why I don't want to have a conversation with you. That's why I don't want to have a debate with you. That's why I don't want to, you know, just sit down and dialogue with you, because you're brutal. You don't have a cultural container by which you can judge this stuff. You may individually have read My Grandmother's Hands or Howard Zinn or whoever else the fuck you know, Bell Hooks or whoever else it is. You may have done that. Cool. Beautiful. Love it. And that is woefully inadequate to deal with the brutality and the terror that my people continue to experience on a day-to-day basis. So until white people begin to grapple with the species question and begin to do something about it, don't tell me you're an ally. An ally is a verb, not a noun. How would I know you're an ally without you telling me? Who are your people? Who are the people that you're cultivating and you're going to spend the rest of your life with cultivating and living embodied anti-racist culture? Other than that, it's performative. You asked me one question and I went off. I know, but I just think that's just, you know.
I want to know, man, that, like, I think too many people go straight into, what is, can you define the theory of, you know,
yes.
Like, let's check in.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Yeah. They go right to the head stuff. They go right to you know, I did a workshop day before yesterday on Friday. And Ryan, I go through this whole thing for 45 minutes. Some of the same stuff that I just said, I go through this whole thing. My woman gets on and she says, Resma, everything you said, I 100% agree with. What I need to know is, what should I do? Now, I just did this for 45 minutes. She goes, can you tell me like maybe two or three or four things I can do right now to, and honestly, she was kind of embarrassed, because I folded my arms and I just looked at her for like 10 seconds. I just looked at her and I was just like, this is why bodies of culture, this is why freedom fighters, this is why football players and basketball players, when they get interviewed, just look at people, look at white reporters like, fuck you. Like, you are literally zapping my life force and you could care less. I just said something for 45 minutes. And after I'm done, you ask me what to do. And you expect me to be cordial. You expect me to be nice. You expect me to give you deference. You actually expect me to answer that question. I said to her, I said, I don't know what the hell you should do. I said, after 45 minutes of me saying what I said, this is what you say to me. That's why bodies of culture think you're dangerous. That's why. And she was a good old liberal white woman teacher, you know, all of the credentialing you could possibly have, right? She has no people. That's why she asked. See, those types of questions are inherently individualistic questions. They're not communal questions, right? If she was communal and she had a people, she would not ask me those questions. Because the people that she's developing peoplehood with and living embodied anti-racist peoplehood with, those people would hold her accountable. They would condition and temper her. They would apply the rules of admonishment and rules of acceptance and help her navigate and develop a spatial understanding of culture. But she doesn't have that. And that question details that.
I love how you, I don't know where you said it, but I heard you only talk to white people with between 3 to 10 years. It's like, get that 3 years and then come talk to me.
Come talk to me.
Yeah.
Get that three years in working with other white bodies,
yes,
and committing to that.
Yes.
That this is the culture I'm going to develop. Not the white bodies that show up to the book club to read My Grandmother's Hands. The 50 people that show up to your online book club to go through My Grandmother's Hands, I guarantee you will not be the people that are left. There will be 9 people left after that 50. And those people have the potential to be your people, not the 50. Mm. Not the 50. And white folks don't understand it. They think that they do an online book club of My Grandmother's Hands, and that's the work. It's not the work. The practices, the cultural resonance that develops from the practice emerges It doesn't happen because you do a book club. It emerges over time. The language emerges over time. The sense of yourself in space emerges over time as you're doing the conditioning and tempering up against each other's bodies. The language, the feel, the sense, the space, the nuance develops. The embodied nuance develops over time. White people think that they read my grandmother's hands and that's it. That ain't it. Mm. So...
And, you know, your book speaks to the answer this woman is, you know, it's not the only answer, but one of the answers for us white folks is spoken about in your work, which is the reason we don't know is because we have this historical trauma that is unprocessed. And we are my ancestors came from lowland Scotland, right on the border with England. Mm-hmm. And for 700 years, they killed each other.
Yeah.
And then they went to Northern Ireland and killed the Irish. And then they came to the U.S. and started committing genocide on Native Americans and then enslaving black folks. And so white people who don't understand that that has an effect is the reason you can come to a Resma talk and say, what should I do? That's how we're disconnected.
So you just you painted something, man. You painted an ancestral lineage that I think is beautiful. All of that brutality that white folks did to other white folks, right? All of that fleeing that white folks did from other white folks, right? Came here and then white folks accepted whiteness. I mean, think about the fuckness of that, right? You got people in Scotland who murdered your people, and then you come here and based on pigmentation, get into bed with those people. Philosophically, you understand what I mean? Organized, like we are white people, right? And all of that terror and brutality that white people perfected on other white people never got processed. The fleeing never got worked out, right? And the reprieval state that was developed was whiteness. That was the reprieve. That was the repair mechanism, right? Was, you know, at least we ain't them. This is why I say white folks got a whole lot of, don't worry about what I'm doing. Don't worry about all the shootings in the South Side of Chicago. Don't worry about all the shootings that black people in proximity to each other do to other black people. Don't worry about that. You got enough shit going on in your head and in your body and unrepaired healing that needs to take place that will keep you and your ancestors busy for the next 300-500 years. So don't worry about what I'm doing in on the South Side of Chicago. Get your life in your shit and your house in order. Don't worry about me. We'll worry about that. We'll work with that. Okay. However, that does not mean that I don't want reparations. Don't get it twisted. That does not mean that I don't want reparations. Reparations and reparations. I want reparations. I want this shit to be repaired. All of that brutality and toil that, and all of that rape for 250 years that you did to my mother's 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 mother's, and that you have my father's 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 participate in, all of that shit. Yeah, I want something for that. I need that to be repaired. I need that to be addressed in the textbooks. I need that to be part of the anti-racist curriculum that you develop. I need you to put an economic, in terms of reparations, there needs to be an economic cost put to the 250 years of state-sanctioned rape, legal rape for 250 years. Yeah, we need to put a cost to that.
And for you, when did the somatic piece become apparent that we were all in our heads? Mm-hmm. And you realize, like, there's no one talking about what's in our bodies. That's like, right. When did that connection happen for you?
And how it keeps getting passed down.
Yeah.
Right.
Tell me that story, like how that sort of.
So it happened. It happened after I got back from Afghanistan. So I was in Afghanistan from 2011 to 2013. After I got back from Afghanistan, my suicide shit was off the chain. And it
like
was,
you were a soldier in Afghanistan?
Or? No, I was a social worker in Afghanistan. So my job, I did. So I was what's called a community care counselor. Right. And so in southern Afghanistan, where I was at, I was stationed in Kandahar. That was my, you know, organizing base. My job, so what a lot of people don't know is that on military bases, the military have people who are dedicated to helping soldiers deal with trauma and stress and stuff like that, right? They have a whole system. They have counselors, they have, you know, clergy, they have people that can deal with it. But if you're a military contractor, you don't get that. You don't have that. Military contractors don't have that. So military contractors are over there doing a lot, like how you get garbage on and off bases, how do you get food on and off bases, how do you get medical supply, right? That's what military contractors do. And they're being subjected to the same brutality, hangings, suicides, breaches, IEDs, all of that different type of stuff. My job was to work with those people on those bases. So so there were supposed to be two of us. Imagine this, there were 17,000 people, military contractors that we had to deal with, right? There was two positions for two of us. So during the 2 years I was there, I ran through six other people that came through that had to leave, right? And so I was basically traveling all around the 53 bases of southern Afghanistan whenever there would be a suicide or some post-traumatic stress stuff or people walking in and their coworker then just hung himself from the rafters or just bananas or the Taliban breaching the bases. I mean, it was just crazy, just, you know, and not to mention, So anyway, so I overrode during that period. I overrode a lot of stuff that I wasn't taking care of, that I should have been taking care of myself, my own stuff, right? That, because I was in that environment too. So I was being exposed to the heat and the smells and the overwhelm and the sounds and the texture and the boom and flinching all the time and, you know, and the, you know, all of that different type of stuff. So then when I got back here and my body started to begin to lean into some of the safety stuff, all of that stuff started coming out, right? Because I'm no longer there, but my body is acting like I'm no longer there. But then there's a consciousness that says you're no longer there. So it's this thing happening. And through all of that stuff, man, and trying to figure it out and not wanting to be here, my wife not being able to help me or wanting to and loving the shit out of me, but not knowing what to do with it, it forced me to start writing and it forced me to start kind of trying to just write this stuff like what's going on, you know, what's happening. And before my grandmother Sands, I'd actually wrote another book called Rock the Boat. I tell people from 2013 to 2015, I don't remember anything in that time period. And I was here, right? I didn't land. Me and my wife was out to dinner, and I remember that. I was like, ooh, I'm here. I landed in like 2017. I actually landed in 2017. And so through all of that, I started writing about my own stuff, and my grandmother's stuff started coming to me. Like her talking about her hands, saying she had arthritis, but she really didn't have arthritis, but she used to pick cotton when she was a baby, and all of that stuff started coming. So that's when the body started coming into me, because I had to, and then some of the training that I had with regard to the body. I'd already had some training, some somatic trainings and stuff like that. So everything started melding together. I started to begin to think, man, like my ancestors, my grandmother picked cotton and she was doing that. What about her ancestors before? What got passed down because her nervous system was attached to another nervous system that learned that there was no reprieve from the horror. So what did that nervous system, how was that nervous system imprinted in a way that it recoiled from something and leaned into something? And how did the little nervous systems around that learning system learn that there was something to be recoiled from or leaned into, but it was decontextualized, right? Like, and so that's where all of the body stuff started coming in for me. It's like, and so I started reading and researching, and that's where I came up with some, you know, learned about the weathering stuff and what happens to the body and cortisol and all that different type of stuff. So that's how it all came together.
And were you also doing therapy like individually with people at the same time around then? Or
Yeah. I don't know how I did it. It's crazy, man. It's crazy. Yeah.
You know, one thing you wrote that I wanted to get your thoughts on is this idea of moving from race to culture is important, transformative, and takes work, a lot of work. Can you describe what you mean for folks, what moving from race to culture means?
Yeah. So it actually is. So there's an organization here called the Cultural Wellness Center here in Minneapolis. And that's what they talk about a lot is I've since adjusted that some. And now I say moving from race to culture to creation. And what I mean by that is that the idea of race is an inherently false concept, right? But I really want to put some parameters around that, because sometimes when people say that, that's where they leave it, right? It's a false concept. You know, it really is not. It's a construction and da da da. Well, it's a construction, and it's a false concept with teeth, with a military, with an economic system. So it's not just a ghost. You know what I mean? I'm not Patrick Swayze, right? You're making a little vase or some shit. It is a false notion. And the very society is predicated on that false notion. But it's a false notion that thou has a military. The philosophy of race, the philosophy of white body supremacy has a policing system. And it's what I call a feral policing structure, right? When you see packs of police officers beating the shit out of an unarmed person, you're watching feral policing. That's embedded in the structure of the United States. There's never been a time where feral policing was divorced from white supremacy. There's never been a time where the sheriff has been divorced from the head of the KKK or the head of the White Citizen Council, right? That's always, but we have this mythos, right, that policing is here to protect. Right. This mythos that there was a point in time where there was this purity around policing and there was a divergence. So you get some bad apples in there. That has never been the case. You know what I mean? That mythos is designed to help white people stay comfortable, which is part of the problem. So the idea of race is a false notion, but is backed by a very potent society. Right. That says that the white body is the standard of human. The white male body is the standard of human. And proximity wise, the white female body gets proximal power from that. Right. And so what I say is that part of race being raced, part of my people being raced, is the acknowledgement that the expression of humanness is culture. Right. That's how you know somebody is human, is that they express culture, the way that they move through time, the way that they talk, cadence, dress, understand, right? All of that is culture. But when something is raced, or when a body is raced, they have no culture. The only culture that they have is the culture by which the majority white culture says it has value. So jazz has value. So now it's culture, right? Rock and roll has value. Now it's culture. Big lips, big booty has value. Now it's culture. You understand what I mean? But what I'm saying is, when I'm talking about the reclaiming of culture, I'm saying we have to move from this idea of race to a reclaiming of culture, an emergent culture, right? And then if you do that long enough, you will see the lines begin to blur with regard to your understanding of culture and your understanding of your place in creation, right? But you have to get a lot of reps in before that happens. You have to get a lot of reps in with people before that happens. You have to get a lot of cultivating in before that happens. And so my thing is, the idea of race, we have to move from that to culture and then eventually slide into the idea of creation. Not a wiping away of my own unique expression of creation, but accepting that as part of the evolutionary process of who we can actually ultimately be as human beings.
Yeah, and I think in your book, you wrote something that helped me on that was this: in order to grow out of white body supremacy, the transformation must largely be led by white Americans. The engine of this transformation will be the creation of a new culture, which will ideally include things like compelling narrative of hope and possibility, one or more credos, past and present heroes, role models, leaders, symbols, rituals. So I think for many white folks, you could go down that list and be like, do we have any credos? Nope.
That's right.
Do we have any past and who were the white heroes?
Specifically, you know? Specifically around embodied anti-racist yes. cultural development. Because yes. white folks will say, well, I'm Scotland now, or I'm yes. Scottish. So I'm going to be now walking around. You know what I mean? Yes. They take the kind of aesthetic understanding of what I said in that, and they just go fucking ham on it. And what I'm saying is, no, that's why I say 3 to 10 years, because you got to spend time with other bodies so whatever needs to emerge can emerge up out of that, not just because you go, okay, we need a credo. Let's develop a credo. We're going to have a credo meeting next week, and so we're going to come up with 7 credos. You see what I mean? That's not culture. That's strategy. Culture develops because you're rubbing up against other bodies and people say, no, I don't like that. And you go, I don't give a fuck if you like it. And you go, you don't give a fuck. You say, no, I don't give a fuck. Well, you say, you need to give a fuck if we're going to be developing this together. Why do I need to give a fuck? Because that's what we're doing here. We're trying to develop these pieces. It will fuck you. No, fuck you. And then you come back next week and you do that again and you come back next week. And then you say, well, you know, I can't come, you know, because I got my baby with it. Bring your baby. I'll hold the baby. I got the baby. Culture develops out of that. Does that make sense?
Absolutely.
Okay.
It's that, yeah, shared accountability and like commitment to each other. And like, it's not, yes.
Specifically around the heat and charge of race.
Yes.
White people are so uncomfortable with race that if you don't watch it, you'll start having cooking parties.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Y'all be sitting up there and you'll be cooking only and never bring up race again. And you know what? Everybody in that room, every white body in that room will be all right with it. Mm. And before you know it, you're not doing anything to usher in the culture.
Yeah.
You're sitting there and you're cooking.
Yeah.
So,
you know, you mentioned in your book, you also talk, you know, so I'll admit coming into 2020, abolishing the police was nowhere on my mind space. It was like deep reform of the police, F the police. But
that's right.
The idea of abolishing them was not.
Yeah.
Now it's, you know, you've written about the need to heal police bodies, and you also live, I think you're in Minneapolis, right? Like,
yeah.
So you live in the one city, or maybe there's more, that has dismantled or is going to dismantle the police. How are you sitting with this idea of like healing the police, but like dismantling and we need to abolish it? Like what is your sort of current
thoughts
on question. That? Yeah.
So my thoughts are evolving with it. I think unless you were a pretty diehard activist, there's a lot of people like this idea of defund the police and abolish the police. It like people kind of like, what the fuck? But I think with all of the things that people have seen, it is not as radical as people, you know, whereas before I think people would be like, well, what the hell? Now people are like, I fucking get it, man. You know what I mean? Even if they don't like full throw to support it, they fucking go, fuck, I get it. Right. And so For me, it really, in terms of the policing and understanding what it is that they go through, to me, doesn't usurp the understanding. It doesn't wipe away the understanding that I have around the how these motherfuckers operate, right? Like me saying, like my brother's a 27-year veteran cop, right? And me and him have some of the wildest fucking talks about stuff. He understands. He goes, I'm a black man first, dude. I get that. I understand what this shit is. He goes, I can't tell you the number of white boys on the police force that I had to slap the shit out of, right? Because they say some funky shit. So just because he's a police officer doesn't mean he's not exposed to white body supremacy in that hierarchy, right? And so for me, some of the healing that I think that has to take place among black police officers and Latino police officers, because some of the pictures that we see involve them motherfuckers participating in this shit. Do you know what I mean? And so what I'm saying is, many times black police officers and Latino police officers are not organizing around what it is that they're actually experiencing in that structure. And so they don't have a lens by which they can judge this. Some people, so I was watching this TikTok or this YouTube, and this little white girl was on there, and she was, you could tell she was on 10, and she was like, you know, I wasn't gonna talk, but I'm gonna talk now. And she said, you know, she said, I just want to address the woman that got up here and talked about how her husband is, you know, a police officer, and she's the wife of a police officer, and that he doesn't like being, you know, spit on and being talked to the way that he's talked to, and, you know, police lives matter too. That's what, and she said, I'm sorry that during this time where a black man has been murdered on the street, that it made you a little uncomfy. She said, but, you know, this is not about, there's no such thing as blue lives. It's a blue fucking shirt, right? And so to me, where I've been kind of thinking about this now is, and I even talk about blue bodies in my book, my thinking has evolved. I will never say that again in my subsequent books. I think we have to separate what are the things that can take place as black police officers begin to come together and address their own unique relationship to policing. They don't have the same relationship as white folks have, white police officers have. So what is the ways in which they are going to develop their own unique understanding? When is the first black police officer going to open up his own online academy specifically focused on how black police officers should be policing? That's how I'm thinking about it. How black police officers should be addressing secondary trauma and vicarious trauma, specifically black police officers. How black police officers should navigate their community being pissed about the murder of another black body and their connection to that community and providing communal policing, right? To me, there is, like I said earlier, there's a difference between communal policing and reimagining policing in concert with people, right? Not as a section, but as a philosophy of how the work should be done. There's a difference between that and what we currently have in what I call feral policing. The feral policing model is instituted and standardized, and it's going to take black police officers in concert with black activists, in concert with black grandmothers, right, to develop a communal policing model, in concert with an economic model, in concert with an educational model for our babies, right? That's how I've been kind of working with this. So to me, defund the police is not just defund the police and giving money to other agencies to because those agencies are replete, those other, you know, child protection agencies and other agencies are replete with white body supremacy also, right? It is, how do we reimagine the feral policing model that currently exists into something else? And I'm not saying that we don't need policing. I'm saying the current model doesn't put people in the equation. So,
yes. And, you know, somebody was breaking it down to me the other day about police budgets usually take 30 to 50% of the budget.
Absolutely. That's why.
A lot of fucking money.
That's a lot of fucking money. And that's why they can't do other things. Yeah. That's why you can't have another policing model, another police, you know, not just a task force, right?
Yeah.
But an actual another model. How does these Black police officers interface with these young Black, older Black men and women who are legally able to go in and work with and work in concert with those police officers so we can affect change before drama happens? Imagine those Black police officers say it is our mission to address the economic gap that exists between Black men and Black women and white women and white men, that it is our, that is a part of what we do in order to affect the crime rate that's happening or something that's happening. Imagine that being part of your ethos and philosophical structure. That is not part of the feral structure.
Is there anything, you know, in the last 10 minutes, I'm wondering if there's anything that you're particularly excited about. Like, is there any of these changes that you're juiced on? You're like, this is the shit right here.
Yeah, I'm excited to see Black football players fucking kneeling in mass. I'm excited to see Black football players like the Dolphins say, fuck, I'm not going out for the national anthem right now. Yeah. I'm done with all of the fucking tweaking around the edges, right? That's, I love seeing Sister Osaka with Breonna Taylor on her mask, right? I love white people being uncomfortable. I love the fact that white people were booing. God, that made me so excited to see the Vikings stand up there with the Green Bay Packers and give respect to the Floyd family and have all of those fucking people booing. Oh my God, that was beautiful. That was why, because I love that white people have no reprieve. There ain't no fucking room. We ain't going back. I love when white people get so fucking whacked out that Black people actually take advantage of the Second Amendment. Oh my God. Seeing Black men walk down with AK-47s walking down the street, right? And white people lose their fucking minds. Oh my God. I get titillated by that type of shit because we ain't going back. We ain't going back. Your comfort is no longer centered. Get used to it. Get used to LeBron James saying Breonna Taylor every fucking time he gets on the mic. Get used to Chris Paul saying it every time they get on the mic. Get used to George Hill saying, I don't want to fucking be. Get used to it. Your shut up and dribble shit is done. Your just don't, you know, don't cause, your comfort is no longer centered. I love seeing Stephen A. Smith getting on a national platform and saying white privilege is at play when Steve Nash gets a head coaching job, jumping over Patrick Ewing, Teron Lue, all of these people, Shaw, all of these brothers that have been toiling and going through it, the quote unquote, the right way that they say it. And Steve Nash gets in a head coaching job, never coached a stitch in his life. On any level, I love the fact that white people don't want to hear that, and they complain. It makes me giddy inside, right? Because there shall no longer be no reprieve for the white body being the standard of humanness, for white comfort trumping Black liberation, indigenous liberation, right? That there shall be no reprieve. And so because you can't sit up and take a fucking beer and watch these beautiful Black men and Black women, WNBA players, play ball, and you never have to hear them as fully fledged human beings, and you're used to that, you can't get that anymore. Fuck you. That gives me so much hope for the future. Mm. Fuck you.
Yeah.
You all right with me dealing with the horror of seeing a black man be murdered constantly and then looking in the face of Chauvin and seeing satisfaction in his fucking face? You all right with that with me, right? But you get uncomfortable when black men and then their teammates and their and white teammates kneeling with them, even if they don't know why the fuck they kneeling, they're doing it. You're uncomfortable with that. You want them to stop. Fuck you. It ain't stopping. It's going to increase everywhere you turn. Everywhere you turn, you're going to be uncomfortable until you change your shit. So that's what gives me hope. That's what makes me giggle in my sleep. That's what makes me, that gets me up in the morning to see black men and black women saying, Breonna was fucking murdered in her sleep. Do something. Do now. That gives the more white people are uncomfortable, the more white women cry, the more people call white women Karens, right? The more people film that shit, the more uncomfortable you fucking are, the better.
Man, you're getting me juice. I'm about to go run around outside yelling at other white people. Wake the fuck up.
Let's not just wake the fuck up, but even if you don't wake the fuck up, I'm going to keep screaming in your fucking ear. You're going to be uncomfortable. There's not going to, in my church, there's not going to, your church, your white church is not a reprieval space. It is not a reprieval space. And if it is a reprieval space, I need to find another church. Your museum is not a reprieval space. If it does become a reprieval space, as a white person who believes in living embodied philosophy, anti-racist philosophy and culture, and what I call somatic abolitionism, as a white body who believes in that, I need to find another fucking church, right? That's how real this shit's got to get. And black people are no longer taking care and centering white comfort. That's what makes me fucking happy. Happy, happy. Fuck you. You don't want to do the work. Don't mean that I'm not, that you go, you ain't go, you're going to not do the work by making a vested choice in not doing the work. And therefore everybody can see you making that vested choice. That don't mean that you get to be comfortable. If I am a fucking football player, I get to do whatever the fuck I want to do, right? I get to use my body and have stewardship over my own body. And you know what? If that makes you uncomfortable, fuck you. You need to do what you need to do, and you need to grow the fuck up, and you need to grow your people up. Fuck you. I'm not just going to stop talking. I'm not. It's never stopping. Anytime you can see a lily white sport like fucking hockey, you can see people starting to kneel, you know the shit done changed. We ain't going back. We ain't going. You watch hockey players kneeling with their black brothers. Fucking NASCAR. This is not episodic. This will continue. We ain't going back. So your comfort is not centered anymore. So you told me what you asked me, what gets me hyped, that's what I'm hyped about. That's what I'm excited about.
Well, thank you. And in the last, I want to be respectful of your time in the last minute here. We often ask guests at the end, what do you need right now? And how can the listeners help you grow your work or the next economy?
What I need right now, personally, what I need, well, two personal things. I need white people to stop asking me what the fuck to do and Google some shit. And you know, and if you are going to ask me what to do, fucking pay me. If you're going to ask black women what to do, fucking pay them. If you're going to ask black activists what to do and to help you through some shit, fucking pay them. Pay them. Fucking pay them. And pay them well. The next thing I would say is, get my grandmother's hands, go through it slow, get the free e-course online at resma.com, get the communal bundles. I have community bundles on my grandmother's hands where you can buy 100 books and then pass them out and give them away to other white folks. Pass them out and give them away. And then slowly go through my book. Follow me on Instagram. I have a lot of free clips and stuff up there that people can just get daily and know and work through some shit. And be gentle with black, brown, and indigenous bodies. Stop putting your need to be educated above their need to grieve and heal. So that's what I would say is what I need. Mm.
Well, Reshma, appreciate you. I see you. Yeah, you're inspiring. And I thank you for everything.
Thanks, man,
being on the show.
I appreciate you, man. Thank you.
Next Economy Now is a production of Lyft Economy. To listen to all of our episodes, go to lifteconomy.com/podcast. That's lifteconomy.com/podcast. You can also sign up for our monthly newsletter at lifteconomy.com/newsletter. Please also rate and review our podcast on iTunes, Spotify, Stitcher, or wherever you get your podcasts. Thanks for listening.